All right, well, thank you. So this is Lisa Hiruki-Ring from NOAA Fisheries, Alaska Fisheries Science Center, and we're doing a follow-up to answer questions from our webinar, our NOAA Live Alaska webinar yesterday that we had on the marine mammal research by the Native Village of Kotzebue with Alex Whiting and Michael Cameron, and we weren't able to get to all of our questions. So we wanted to do a supplemental video to answer, to follow up and answer the questions that we weren't able to get to. So I have Michael Cameron and Alex Whiting on the line, and I will go off camera so that we can focus on them and we'll get started with our questions. Okay, so I think the first question that we weren't able to get to was from Jesslyn and from the Kodiak Island Borough School District. And that question was, do these seals only live in cold water or do they live in warm water too?
Michael, can take your question. Okay.
The seals that we were mentioning in this project are all ice-associated seals. And as such, they tend to spend most of their time only in cold waters. Some of the seals, for example, ribbon seals, sometimes spotted seals, and some of them will move into slightly warmer waters, even as far south as off the coast of Oregon or Washington. But that's in many cases rare for the entire population. So most of them are, that we're studying, are just in the Arctic. There are, of course, lots of seals that spend time in warm water. But those were not the focus of our presentation.
Okay, great. And Alex, did you want to add anything to that, or?
Well, I would just say that the young bearded seals, although you know the water is relatively cold here all year, even during the summer, in the fall time, one of the areas we first targeted them was in the very shallow water, where there's grassy islands that they like to crawl up onto and warm up in the sun. It allows them to save some energy and save calories. And also to, it's easier for them to learn to feed in the very shallow water. So they, the young bearded seals at least, their first few months, they like to be in relatively shallow water, which is the warmest water that's in the area at the time.
Thank you. Yeah, it's interesting to think about all of the different behaviors that the seals have at different times of their lives. We had a question from Alice who wanted to know whether bearded and ring seals are related.
Bearded and ring seals are related, but very distant relations. Bearded seals are actually one of the oldest clade of seals, a very ancient lineage of pinnipeds, of seals. They're very different than most of the other seals that we've been discussing. For example, bearded seals have four mammary glands, four teats versus two. And there's lots of other parts of their physiology that indicate that they evolved much earlier in the spectrum than these other seals. So all seals are related in some way, but ringed and bearded are quite distant in the evolutionary timescale.
And then when you're talking about physiology, that means like the way that their body works, right? So things like how well they can, like you said, how they feed their young with milk, or how their lungs are developed and stuff like that. Is that kind of how you define it?
Yes, that's exactly right. Another example of the differences are that most of the seals that we've mentioned, the ringed, the ribbon, and the spotted seals, when all seals lose their hair once a year, but the ringed, ribbon, and spotted seal lose it over a very short period of time, over a couple weeks or up to a month. The bearded seal, however, is sort of continuously regrowing its own coat. So that's just one other example of a difference in the physiology between the two species.
Oh, that's interesting. I didn't realize that. Alex, did you have any other things to add to that?
No, that sounds good.
Great. So moving on to the next question, Patrick had wanted to know, have you ever gotten bitten by a seal while tagging?
I haven't. I don't know about Michael.
I haven't been bitten by a seal yet, but I know a lot of, there are some of my colleagues who have been bitten by seals. These are wild animals. They, by and large, don't want to be caught. They want to escape, and sometimes when they try to escape by biting. Luckily, I haven't been bit, but I say yet, because the more you do it, the more likely it is to happen eventually.
Now, Jerry was asking, and she's from Juneau, consuming seal meat is a treat for Tlingits in Southeast Alaska. Has climate change altered the quality of the meat?
That's my question. So what climate? So although it's somewhat hard to say what exactly can be blamed on climate change, in recent years, there has been more examples of having blubber on a lot of seals, especially bearded seals, that is either very thin or even yellowish brownish in color. And that's related in some way to the broader environment, whether that's food availability or warmer temperatures or more difficult ice conditions, which means maybe more difficult conditions just generally for some particular seals in some areas. So I guess while we can't specifically blame anything on climate change, there, for some people anyways, they believe that there's been changes in the health of some of the seals that is likely or may be related to climate change, I guess.
Yeah, I just add that the quality of the meat, the muscle, is mostly just a function of what the animal is able to eat. And if climate change is impacting the prey or the distribution of the prey, that I suppose could be impacting the meat. As Alex mentioned, there are some studies that show changes in body condition, which is basically just how fat an animal is. For how long it is, but that's not consistent among all species and locations and times of year. I think the main thing to remember, though, is that these seals in Alaska are all healthy and safe to eat. So in terms of the quality of the meat, in terms of interested in eating it, it's still very safe to eat when prepared in traditional ways.
Yeah, I would also mention that in 2011 and then maybe again in 2015, we had unusual mortality events where there was widespread seals that had various signs of disease like pox marks or very bald or other conditions that weren't healthy in appearance. And while a lot of observations and sampling was done in both of those, it's still not entirely clear what the cause of those conditions were, especially the pox-like and that kind of conditions. But that also may or may not be related to climate change. We are seeing in marine mammals generally around the world, We in the last 10 years, including the couple of examples in Alaska of these unusual mortality events. There has been unusual mortality events that all of which in some way may be related to the warming waters and the additional stresses that are put on marine mammals. And so as the conditions change, the marine environment is very sensitive to rapid changes in temperatures like we're having, and ocean acidification, and then human development activities. There's a lot of different things that can stress out marine mammals, and some of that can show up in these disease events or unusual mortality events.
Yeah, that's very interesting. We did have another question from Kristen that could be related to this. She was asking whether seals are affected by chemical contaminants or chemicals, and I know that's been something that people have been testing for.
Yeah.
I'll take that one, Alex. You're right, Lisa. There's been quite a lot of testing and interest in testing for chemicals and other contaminants and pollutants in seals, in many ways because these are animals that are used as a primary food source. And so researchers from the Alaska Department of Fish and Game, the North Slope Borough, NOAA, us, for years we've been collecting samples either from the harvest or, in the case of NOAA, from wild-caught animals, collecting tissue samples and testing them for contaminants. I'll say at the outset that these sorts of sampling and testing has actually been occurring not just in Alaska, but throughout the world. And repeatedly in these studies, seals in Alaska and Canada are considered the ones with the lowest levels of any contaminants. Those in Russia often have some of the highest levels of any contaminants. That being said, it's important to recognize that for nearly any mammal in the world, if you were to be testing tissues for these, you're likely to find some evidence of these chemicals somewhere. But these tests are very sensitive, and so being able to detect the presence of certain chemicals doesn't necessarily mean that it's very detrimental to that animal or would necessarily be really bad to eat. So again, the take home is that overall seals in Alaska are healthy and safe to eat, but because there are contaminants and pollutants in the environment, they do show up. Various pollutants and contaminants do show up while testing. Biggest concern that I think we have now, which is sort of an emerging concern related to climate change, is the increase in what are known as harmful algal blooms, or HABs. With warming temperatures throughout the world, we're seeing increasing amounts of algae. Sometimes these algae can produce a what's called a saxitoxin, or a particular neurotoxin that can be bad for humans if they eat. Mostly these are accumulated in animals that are filter feeders, like clams. And there was a sort of notable harmful algal bloom that occurred in the Nome Bering Strait region, I think just last year, with their warm temperatures. There were rather high concentrations of those algae, and my understanding is because there was continued testing, they were able to recognize that it was high and inform folks of the region that it wasn't safe at that time to harvest clams. This is the same sort of thing that happens throughout the world, including the US. Frequently at different parts of the lower 48, people will be told it's not safe to eat clams. You need to wait a few months until those harmful algal blooms subside. So it's an increasing concern that more and more monitoring is being put towards.
Great, thanks. Alex, did you want to add anything else?
No. That's all right.
Go ahead.
Oh, Now, the Native Village of Kotzebue has been monitoring both contaminants and this harmful algae around here. And like Mike said, that as the waters warm with climate change, that's one of the likeliest impacts that is going to occur, is more harmful algae blooms, more toxins, and people are going to have to continue to learn about that, because every year it's going to be slightly different. Every year we're going to increase our understanding. But harmful algae blooms in the Arctic, as far as I can tell, weren't a thing until recently. And so, but that's no longer true. And so, yes, we're going to have cooperative projects like we did with the seal tagging on making sure that these animals are safe going into the future, where we have NOAA and state and especially local people helping to collect and monitor for these blooms going forward. And the Native Village of Kotzebue has been doing that for some time now.
Yeah, that actually reminded me of you talking about what kids can do every day to collect that kind of information, which is to just observe what's going on around their communities and write it down. And I know that you had said something about that in the presentation yesterday as well.
Yeah, I did want to encourage some of the teachers or some of the classes that were listening in to maybe have a journal writing exercise, like the journal that I showed, where basically on a week-to-week basis, I note down what's happening in our local environment, including things like harmful algae blooms. That's one of the things when they happen around here, when they're noticeable or when we detect them, that I put down in my journal. So yes, I think it would be great if some of these classes did that at least for a week or a semester or some amount of time, where they practice observing whatever around them, the environment or anything that's of interest to them, and writing it down and keeping a journal. And that's a very good exercise, and I think it'll be helpful to some people if they continue on with that going forward.
Yeah, that's great. And I also wanted to alert teachers to a local network called the LEO Network, and because that's also a way that local community members, students, schools can note things like harmful algal blooms that might be happening in their area and alert others to something that's happening. Because I think sometimes the folks that are at the location that where things are happening can pinpoint when things first start happening. I was thinking about what you were talking about, Alex, with the seals that were showing up with lesions and looked like they were sick. And I think those were first reported by communities that were seeing the seals coming up on the beach.
Yeah, so that's the thing, is that in Alaska especially, science works best when you have collaboration or cooperation, when you have both local community people and federal and state researchers communicating about stuff that's happening, because Alaska is so big that it's impossible for state and federal researchers to know what's going on everywhere. And at the same time, the local people need some of the tools and expertise that the state and federal researchers have. And so that's really why these collaborations, like many which we have talked about, are so valuable and necessary, is because basically the local communities and the outside researchers need each other in order to really make research not only productive, but actually have the necessary knowledge. Yes, Alaska is so big that it takes a lot of people participating in order to understand what's going on, I guess is what I'm saying. And so that's why these collaborations, these cooperative projects are so important and valuable.
I completely agree.
Thanks. So Adriana, who's a seventh grader from the Hooper Bay Charter School, wanted to know, is there a relationship between the decline of salmon population to the seal population?
You want to take that, Marco?
Short answer right now is we don't know the extent to which changes in the seal population might be impacting the salmon population. We do know that the salmon population in the area, so I'll start off by saying I'm not a fisheries biologist, but I've heard from other presentations that we know that there have been changes in the salmon population. My understanding is that most of those changes are related to, are presumed to be related to changes in the ecosystem related to climate change, whether it's warming waters or changing prey distributions. But it's also possible, of course, that a predator like a seal could also be impacting the salmon. But at the moment, I'm not sure we have the data to say whether or not or how much that could be occurring.
Alex, anything to add?
So yeah, the changes in the ocean are likely impacting both species. The one thing that's probably not helpful though is when you have low salmon runs, like on the Yukon River, both Chum and King, maybe all their salmon runs there. Spotted seals eating more of those salmon, or spotted seals eating salmon at all when you have such a low amount of salmon is probably not helpful. But the seals are not, very likely not the cause of any of the salmon declines, but some seals, like spotted seals, do prey on salmon. And so when you're trying to rebuild a run, it's probably not helpful to have additional predation by spotted seals.
Yeah, that's very true. Thanks, Alex. I'm going to circle back to some of the questions from earlier in the webinar that I missed. Michelle had wanted to know, why do seals haul out?
You could talk about
it. You want to start, Alex, or should I?
You could, go ahead.
Okay. Seals haul out onto the ice or onto land for a lot of reasons. They can haul out to rest, to take a nap. They use sea ice. The seals we're discussing use sea ice as a platform to give birth to their pups or to nurse their pups. The other really important aspect that happens with haul out is when an animal hauls out of the water, its skin temperature, at least if it happens in the spring and summer months, its skin temperature increases. And an increasing skin temperature is what is required to help the animal grow a new coat of hair. So being able to haul out onto the sea ice allows the animal to grow a new coat of hair. And that's important because hair is really useful in being able to help protect the animal against parasites, for example, or abrasions. And so having a good clean coat of hair once a year is beneficial to them. So being able to haul out has lots of benefits. Being able to warm the animal, giving it a place to rest and take care of and give birth to their young.
Thanks, Mike. Alex?
Oh, and one more. It also can help provide protection against certain predators. So there's some evidence that spotted seals or may be using sea ice as a way to gain protection from killer whales, which obviously cannot haul out onto sea ice. I've been out conducting surveys and been seeing a lot more animals hauled out than I would have otherwise expected. And then we saw a large pod of killer whales in the area. So predator, being able to avoid predators is also a useful reason to haul out.
Very cool. Alex, anything else that you want to say?
That sounds about right. The one thing to keep in mind is that water steals heat from your body maybe 25 times faster than air does. And so when seals are able to haul out, in addition to having the sun, they can save a lot of calories, especially if it's sunny out, because they're not burning any calories to stay warm. Even though their blubber is a great insulator, it's still true that, as most of us know, that when you jump into cold water, it's a lot different than jumping into cold air as far as how fast you lose heat and how cold you feel. So
very, very, very true. Mrs. Cooper's class from Kotzebue was wondering, what is the most aggressive breed of seal?
Spotted seals. spotted seals are not, they're the least favorite seal to catch in the net because they're the least, they have the sharpest, biggest teeth, and they're the most aggressive, and they're sort of the scariest to try to deal with, from untangling them from the net and trying to not get bit. So early on in this project, we did in fact catch 5, I believe, spotted seals in nets. I think that was the first year or two. Early on, we did that, but Michael's the one that has been mostly up close and personal with spotted seals, so maybe he could say a few words about that.
Of the seals we've spoken about on this presentation, definitely spotted seals would be the most aggressive. Frequently, when we're done handling an animal and we've released it from the net and we've tagged it and we've sampled it, and we want it to go back in the water, it's often that a spotted seal will turn around and try and attack us instead of escaping, like all of the other seals would just try and go into the water. Spotted seals sometimes will first turn around and let us know they were not happy. I have also worked in Antarctica, however, and leopard seals are not the nicest animals to be around if you're an animal at all. But I would say the most aggressive animal that I've ever worked with was the northern fur seal. Even pups, when they're, these are fur seals are in the Pribilof Islands, is their primary haul out location. Even as pups, they'll come out and they just start snarling and want to bite everything in sight. So they're pretty aggressive also.
Very, very interesting stories. Yeah, it's interesting to see the personality of the species, so to speak, when you're talking about spotted seals turning around and kind of letting them know that they weren't happy with being captured.
And I guess I should mention too that some of the bearded seal that we captured, including the one that you guys saw in the pool down in California, are just like a puppy. That one in particular, I knew it was going to be a great candidate for that project, for being in captivity and for training, because, well, actually we had two at the time, and one was a male that was very aggressive and roaring at us, and standing as high as it could on its flippers and coming at us. But that one that you saw in the video just didn't really move a whole bunch, and actually at times would even turn over on its back and let you scratch its belly and just basically lay there just like a puppy. It was just like a nice puppy. And so what that does show you is that bearded seals can be the mellowest of all the seals, but it also, that's an example of all these animals have their own personalities. Especially bearded seals, I notice more than anything, they all have different personalities, from really aggressive to very docile. And so that's one of the things you learn when you work with animals, is they're all not the same. They all sort of have a different take on how they're going to act and respond. So we've seen very radical differences between bearded seals anyways.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So let's see, Amanda's class had a question of, do seals stay in family groups?
You can take a crack at that.
Okay. No, they don't, not in the way that you're thinking. You may be, meaning that they don't have a mom and a father and a pup that stick together for long periods of time. Certainly not these ice-associated seals that we've been discussing. And a large reason for that is these animals are hauling out onto sea ice and giving birth in the spring. And by the summertime, most of that sea ice has then melted. And by then, that sort of dissolves the bond between the mom and the pup. You may have, however, heard of a triad. Sometimes when we're out in the spring, when moms are giving birth to their pups, there will be another male nearby waiting to breed with that mom once she has weaned her pup. That's called a triad, three. But almost certainly that male that's with that mom and her pup, that male is not the father of that pup. So it's not something that's normal with these species.
Thanks, Mike. Alex?
No, that sounds right. It's not kind of a Disney Lion King situation with the seal.
Cool. So we had some questions about the tagging study that you did. And so Mrs. Ravenscroft's class from Akaton School had wanted to know whether you put the seals to sleep when you tag them.
The one thing we do that we showed yesterday is we have hoop nets. It's just a big net with big mesh that in a hoop that we can keep the seal kind of corralled in that net. And then we use stretchers to move them around. The one thing we will do is, so we don't put them to sleep. There's no drugs involved with them. The one thing we do though, in a lot of cases, is to cover their eyes. All animals, for the most part, are calmer and easier to work with when their eyes are covered. They don't have as much things coming at them, as much visual stimuli. That's something we did. And then, of course, we try to be gentle with them. Even though we talked about the aggressive nature of some of these seals, at least for ring seals and bearded seals, the vast majority of them are pretty mellow by nature. And as long as you're not rough and aggressive with them, and again, covering their eyes with, you know, a cloth of some sort, then they're fairly easy to work with and fairly cooperative and mellow. And so we generally didn't have any problems at all. But yeah, we didn't use any tranquilizers or anything like that.
So it's a little different for the work that we do on ribbon and spotted seals and large bearded seals. For those really large animals that we need to be able to work with, we found that it's safer for the animal and for us if we can sedate them, especially spotted seals, for the reasons that we already mentioned. In the same way that Alex mentioned that keeping them calm is important, we generally whisper while the animal is sedated. If it's a mom with a pup that we've captured, we don't sedate the pup, it's just adults, but we'll keep the pup really close to the mom's face so she can either smell the pup or hear its vocalizations. That helps to calm the mom to know that her pup is nearby. So oftentimes the sedation is a light sedation just to kind of calm them down, not always just to completely put them to sleep. We found that we can complete the work in half the time if we can sedate these larger animals. And the other advantage of the chemicals that we use, the drugs that we use to sedate them, is that there's a reversing agent. So once we know that we're done with the work, we can inject them with a reversing agent, and almost immediately the animal is back, I was going to say back on its feet, back on its flippers, and able to enter the water. So we sedate, our group tends to sedate adults for the most part.
Okay, great, thank you. We had another question about the flipper tags. Kristen was wondering what the cost of the flipper tags are that record location.
There's lots of different types of flipper tags. The ones that we were using an R study, gave information on location as well as haul out, the timing of hauling out, and they had a way to kind of conserve battery use. All of those things add to the cost. So it's a long way of saying the tags that we used in our project, I think, were on the order of $1,200 to $1,800 each. But I know that it's possible to get ones for less than $1,000 for the flipper tags. For the satellite tags that go on their backs, just like anything, it depends upon how big the batteries are and how many sensors there are. Those can range anywhere from $2,000 to $8,000, depending on the sensors.
Yeah, that's quite a bit of a difference. And then there was a question about the study where you were looking at where bearded seals spent their time in the years after you put the flipper tags on them. They were wondering whether the seals would pass the site fidelity onto their offspring, onto their pups.
There are, so not in these seals that we've mentioned, there are some species that have what's called natal site fidelity, natal meaning where they were born. And if the animal is returning back to the same location, if the mom is returning back to the same location year after year to give birth, then in some species, there's evidence of the pup returning to that same location. That is, we don't currently have hard evidence of that occurring in these ice-associated seals. It's possible that it may occur in ring seals, but that's the extent of our ability to test. In order to really know that, we would have to repeatedly capture a mom and her pup and be able to record where the animal's coming and going over its lifetime. And that's a very difficult thing to do with these species.
Alex, anything to add?
No, like Michael said, we did some work on genetic testing. So when the seals come out and they molt that we talked about in the springtime, and that when we showed the pictures of those dogs down at Sadie Creek, one of the things that we did for those couple of years was you can collect the skin flakes. So if you look around the seal holes in the springtime, when they're molting, when they're shedding their skin and their fur and their whiskers, all of those things have genetic material, DNA. And so if you collect those from the same locations year after year after year, that's one other way you can at least use DNA to determine whether the same seals are coming back or whether the seals are related to each other that are coming back. But there's been not a whole lot of long-term ongoing studies in that area. But we did do some of that of collecting and looking at DNA and trying to understand whether the ring seals like salmon are coming back to the same place where they were born year after year, or even if the pups weren't coming back, whether the female was coming back to the same place every year to give birth to pups. So yeah,
great, thanks. And we have one final question, and thank you for taking all this time to answer the questions that we had from the webinar. Calla from the Bay public the charter school was asking, why does NOAA focus only on the study about seals?
Well, we don't. NOAA studies a lot of different animals, as well as a lot of other parts to the environment, and more in other places other than Alaska. Just the laboratory where my program is responsible for studying seals, but I'm part of a larger laboratory called the Marine Mammal Laboratory. And in my lab, there are other people that study California sea lions, northern fur seals, Steller sea lions, as well as lots of different species of whales, cetaceans, dolphins, porpoises, and the like. And that's just in our lab. Then in our same building, we have a bunch of other people that study everything from crabs to fish to plankton. On our same campus, we have other people that study the oceans and the chemical composition of the oceans. We have people that study weather. We have a lot of different things that NOAA does. I think that the seal work is easily the most interesting and the worth funding, but I guarantee that NOAA does a lot of different research, and not just in Alaska, throughout all of the United States and in other parts of the world as well.
Alex, do you want to say anything more?
Yeah, we work with NOAA on Kotzebue Sound beluga stuff, and even on some of the fish and ocean stuff that Michael's talking about. So, the Native Village of Kotzebue also does more than look at seals. We try to study the entire ecology of Kotzebue Sound, and in some of those areas, NOAA is also doing research. And so whenever we have opportunities to collaborate or work with, or even just talk to NOAA about these other areas besides seals, then we have been doing that also.
And thank you very much. And I also had wanted to say that, you know, for our students who are watching today, if you're interested in finding out other ways that NOAA works with Alaska communities, you can go look at past webinars from our NOAA Live Alaska webinars, because we had folks who were talking about tsunamis and snow depth and river breakup and invasive species, as well as marine mammals and fish and sharks. So there's a lot of different areas where NOAA does research, and like Mike said, not only in Alaska, but all over the world as well. So that was the last of our questions from yesterday's webinar. So thank you very much. And if you have any other parting words of wisdom to give to our students, and we can have those and then end after that.
No, I'm good. I just appreciate everyone's interest in the work that we do, and I encourage all the students, if they're interested in this kind of work or other work in the environment, to follow their interest, to learn more about it, and to keep learning and keep your curiosity going about the oceans. But I appreciate everyone's interest in our project. Thank you.
Exactly right. Keep the curiosity, but also share what you know with other people. All that knowledge builds on knowledge, and we all learn from one another. And keep having fun while you're doing it.
The most important part. Okay, well, thank you very much, Michael. Thank you, Alex. And yeah. I really appreciate both the webinar that you gave yesterday and the extra time you're taking to answer everybody's questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Mm-hmm.